We did not want this war. But in refusing to give up his weapons of mass destruction, Saddam gave us no choice but to act.
Sure.
It's a very difficult question to unpick whether Britain was right to invade Iraq. It's easy in retrospect to say no because of all of the challenges that came as a result of it. I think we have to think about it in terms of the decisions made at the time in 2002 to 2003 and try and unpick those to look at the rationale behind them and in order to decide whether it was right to think about whether those rationales were right, of which I think there are two kind of key big arguments that came out at the time. One was the humanitarian intervention to try and protect the people of Iraq from what the West certainly saw as a brutal dictator.
No, Britain was not right to invade Iraq. It was a crime of aggression. It was without legal or moral justification. We were all involved in a vast criminal, what in my view, is quite an extreme view, criminal conspiracy of aggression. That said, I think most, maybe 95%+ British soldiers, all the ones I saw, with a couple of exceptions, behaved in that highly stressful environment extremely well. That doesn't justify the operation. We failed in any strategic objective that could be identified. To the extent that we had any objectives, they failed. There was no humanitarian purpose for it.
The second rationale was also an issue of security, but focused on weapons of mass destruction and the question over whether intelligence that was leading to the suggestion that Saddam had both the capability to develop weapons of mass destruction and the rationale to use them was right.
We did our best in a very bad situation, I'd say that. When we got on the ground, there simply weren't enough of us. And I think the people of Basra wanted some order. They wanted to be able to go about their business, to buy and sell their stuff, to go to school, go to college, go to work, without being harassed by bunches of militias or gangsters. And the trouble is, in a lawless environment, militias and gangsters flourish. Right? The government had been lifted away, huge instability. So what they wanted, quite understandably, if there are lots of armed men around, and we were the biggest and best gang in town, then it behooves them to try and preserve some order. But we had nowhere near the resources to do that.
On the city's new law, British soldiers, who for quite some time will be Basra's police and government. From their foxholes and behind piles of dirt, they watch Basra's main road, blocked for more than a week by British tanks.
When I was there, which was in 2003 to 2004, and I think this went on for a few months beyond, we thought the major risk was Al-Qaeda terrorists attacking us, or old Ba'athist remnants, let's say, that of sympathizers of the old regime of Saddam Hussein. These people weren't interested in attacking us. They were interested in preserving their own lives. They were being chased by the Shia militias, who were the real risk to us and to order in Basra. We didn't realize that for, well, probably 2 years.
Shia militiamen from the Mahdi army battling Islamic State fighters last month close to the city of Tikrit. But the Amnesty report accuses the militias of carrying out abductions, torture and executions against the Sunni civilian population.
That was an intelligence failure on its own. But the real people who suffered, we lost, what, 179 killed and a few hundred very badly injured, including friends of mine, right? So I'm not belittling that. I knew people who were killed there and still know people who are very seriously injured. But the main people who suffered were the people of Basra, hundreds or thousands of people killed in Basra being the wrong religious sect, killing each other in Baghdad because of the Sunni Shia divide. In Basra, it was mainly Sunnis that were being killed. There was no way we could impose any sort of order or circumstance that would allow development to take place. And even if we had, who was going to provide that?
They feel they are second-class citizens, stigmatized and repressed. This has added fuel to the Sunni insurgency, invoking the specter of al-Qaeda extremism.
The question about whether they went to war for the right reasons depends on whether you believe the discussions and the debates that were put forward by the British government at the time, which was focused upon the brutal dictatorship of Saddam Hussein and the need to help support the Iraqi people. And the second rationale was that Saddam Hussein was actually a direct threat to the West because of his ability, capability, and desire to develop weapons of mass destruction, which could be used against the West and their allies.
The only humanitarian crisis in Iraq, as far as I can see, was caused by our sanctions and, of course, the predations of Saddam Hussein. But Saddam Hussein was not the only dictator and certainly presented no threat to the United Kingdom.
There needed to be greater understanding of what were the next steps following the toppling of Saddam.
These are the men the bombs are trying to hit. This evening, Iraqi television showed President Saddam Hussein meeting some of his most trusted commanders.
Saddam Hussein had nothing to do with the al-Qaeda organization, and nor has Saddam Hussein anything at all to do, and they knew nothing about, as far as we could gather, the 9/11 attacks before they took place. I have no brief for Saddam Hussein. He was a vicious, murdering dictator. But what we can say is that his regime had nothing to do with 9/11. And by that, I can say that with some degree of authority, because one of our requirements was to determine if that was the case, and we found no evidence whatsoever. Furthermore, my team not only found no evidence, but found evidence that the Iraqi intelligence services themselves had no involvement and would have wanted no involvement. It's important to remember that Saddam was the kind of dictator that a secular Ba'athist dictator that al-Qaeda found particularly obnoxious. Two evils don't make a right. Al-Qaeda is an evil organization, but so was Saddam Hussein. That doesn't mean that they were in any way in cahoots. Absolutely.
So because they had underestimated Saddam Hussein's stockpiles and capabilities in the Gulf War, what then happened was the intelligence agencies overcompensated, we now know, by overestimating his capabilities. So the intelligence was suggesting that there was weapons of mass destruction. However, it was based on false intelligence from some human intelligence sources, a reliance on human intelligence, which is always difficult, and there was no intelligence insight into Saddam's inner circle because he kept it so tight. It's difficult to find where weapons of mass destruction could be refined and made in satellite imagery. And so there's a lot of guesswork and trying to put together the pieces. And unfortunately, the answer that they came up with wasn't the right one.
So if we hadn't got involved in this invasion, nothing would have happened to us. Germany didn't get involved. France wasn't there. Many European countries weren't there. Many major global powers, in fact, most major global powers actively opposed it. So no, we would have paid very little penalty. Indeed, just prior to the war, the Americans, understanding the opposition that Tony Blair faced within the UK, said, look, we don't really need your involvement. If you want to be involved in a very small scale, that's fine. And Blair said, no, we want to go in big, go in alongside you. Blair being the Prime Minister at the time, who I believe is guilty of the war crime of aggression.
The weapons of mass destruction that people are trying to develop and nuclear proliferation, then it's important that we look at every single way we possibly can of dealing with this threat. Now, as the President said a moment or two ago, we don't have a specific proposal on the table yet. But I understand and share the American concerns, as I've said many times before. And I think what is important is that if we take this forward in a constructive way and have the right discussion with allies, then we can find a way through this. I've always believed that, incidentally, and I believe that even more firmly having talked to the president today.
There's also questions around whether Britain overcommitted to supporting the US in their determination to go to war against Iraq. And there are all sorts of levels about understanding about why the American government was keen to attack Iraq.
Blair decided to invade Iraq for two reasons that were complementary. First, it may be that Blair believed that Iraq had some weapons that they might or might not have been able to use against Cyprus or something like that, or neighbours of Iraq.
During the course of these discussions, do you think you gave him any commitments?
The only commitment I gave, and I gave this very openly at the meeting, was a commitment to deal with Saddam.
Now, so you were at one that you had to deal
with? Absolutely. So, and that wasn't a private commitment, that was a public commitment.
So you were agreed on the end, but not on the means?
That doesn't justify the invasion in most people's minds, in most lawyers, or indeed most ordinary people, but there we are, let's say. But the primary reason was that Blair wanted to show that Britain was going to stand alongside the United States, whatever. He'd given that, and this is documented, he'd given that undertaking to George Bush just after 9/11, we're with you, without conditions. And I believe that's why Blair went in. Now, that's a legitimate strategic decision to make, actually. It's not, it doesn't make the invasion legitimate, but it's legitimate to take the view that we must stand beside the US. I'm not criticising that. But then don't lie about it. And that's what happened.
I believe that Tony Blair believed what he was saying, that he was provided with certain intelligence, and that he believed that it was a threat. The problem was that the intelligence was wrong, and that sometimes when you believe a certain thing, you follow and listen to the people that support your beliefs and don't necessarily take on board those kind of challenges that you should do.
We have to look at the Chilcot report, which has concluded that the evidence was not objectively present to justify any military action against Iraq.
Despite promises that Cabinet would discuss the military contribution, it did not discuss the military options or their implications.
But ultimately, the decision always comes down to the Prime Minister. So in that case, it was Tony Blair. Obviously, there were many people feeding into his decision, but he made the decision.
For all of this, I express more sorrow, regret, and apology than you may ever know or can believe.
Iraq has, I think, or for a decade or more, trashed Britain's reputation globally.
The fact that Britain was not able to achieve its objectives in Iraq, that it was harder than they thought, has had a number of knock-on effects. One is the way that other countries view Britain as not as strong as it used to be, the same with America. Two is that Britain has had to take quite a internal reflection upon why it failed, what the lessons that could be learnt from the war in Iraq are, and how it would fight wars in the future.
We scrutinise our government's decisions. We preserve a free press. We look very carefully at their account. Doesn't mean we disbelieve it, but we look very carefully and critically.
In terms of the military, there's been a lot of changes since the war in Iraq, and the military have been critical of themselves. They have taken the time to reflect and learn lots of lessons. The British military has a good reputation worldwide, and I don't think that the war in Iraq has had a significant dent in that.
The one major lesson we must draw from the disaster of Iraq is we comply with the old traditions of just war, and we go to war only in just cause or in self-defense. Those just war ideas are the same in Western tradition, Judeo-Christian or Islamic tradition, or the East Asian traditions. We do not attack without good reason. That means you can also develop a coherent strategy with the support of your people, which is absolutely vital in any military campaign.